Happy Sabbath. It's a pleasure to stand here today to welcome each and every one of you in church, to our visitors here, and those who is online, special welcome to our Sabbath fellowship. Regular members, welcome again. Let us all join together in giving thanks and praises to our God and King. Psalms 34, verse 8. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusted in him. Let us all enjoy the word of God.
Let us stand. Brethren, in time like these, we are troubled. A lot of things is going on, but Jesus say, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, amen, he's faithful. In my Father's house, there are many mansions, and if it was not so, I would have told you. And he's faithful. He said, if I go to prepare your place, I'll come again. And he will come again because he's faithful.
Let's solemnly pray. Father in heaven, amen. You are awesome.
Yes.
And because you are awesome, we love to serve you. Even this day, this beautiful Sabbath day that you have set aside for us, when you look at our people, yes, many of our apparatus may not be here, but you are here,
yeah.
And we are here to worship you.
Amen.
We do not need music. We do not need all of that stuff, but we surely need you.
Amen.
Bless your people. Bless your waiting congregation. And as we come to receive a message, let us willing to spread and to tell of the good news. We pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
There is only 4 weeks left for your sight and sound trip. Have you secured your spot? If not, Sister Panton is asking that you come on in with your funds. $90 for children, $180 for adults. Sister Panton may not be visible for another 2 weeks, so she wants you to go to Sister Belvinda Thompson, Sister Belvinda Thompson, and submit your money. Now, some of you may not be able to go, but you could afford to sponsor someone, whether partially or in full. She's asking you to see her and or Sister Belvinda Thompson and sponsor someone. So there are those who want to go, but they cannot afford to. You can also see Sister Panton or Sister Belvinda. Time is running out. The bus leaves at 6 a.m. on August 18th. Secure your spots. The seats are going fast. Once again, your sight and sound trips, bring your money in order to make it on the bus. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. I hope you could hear very well. And if you can hear, you see. And please take notes of those announcements. Put them on your calendars. Also, July 2nd will be our prayer and fasting. We ask for total participation. July 2nd, our prayer and fasting. On July 9th to the 22nd will be our evangelistic series. Our evangelistic series will be July 9th to the 22nd. And we'll be focusing on what book? The book of Revelation. Amen? The book of Revelation. So we are asking for full participation. Bring a friend. Bring your relative. Give them the link so that they can experience this grand and awesome book. We can learn about God's revelation. For it to be a success, remember, we all need to take part. Amen. Next week, so the series will be will be nightly except Mondays and Thursday. Okay? The series will be conducted nightly except Mondays and Thursdays. Amen? Remember that. And it will be also live stream on Zoom and YouTube. Also, next week, our elders will be going on visitation. We'll be visiting our members. I ask you, if you have anyone that you know, relatives, friends, members, that you know that we should visit, please let any one of our elders know. We ask you, give us a name. Yourself, your relative, you know, a church member that you need, that require a visit, please let any one of these elders give a name, and we will be happy to do so. Also, we ask you, please, if anyone is sick, if you know anyone of our members that were sick, please let us know. We will not know unless you tell us. And then when we know, now it is up to us, we need to act. But do not keep it. If you know anyone of our church member that is sick, let us know. Let the elders know, and we will all will give them the proper pastoral, may I say, the pastoral treatment or the pastoral visit or the attention, whatever it takes to them. So please remember to support the Wednesday night recharge. Amen. Very, very important, so that we can rejuvenate, we can recharge for the next week, for the next days. So that's the end of the announcement. May we, as we worship today, we will worship in spirit and in truth. One last thing, I would like to call up Brother Daly. Brother Daly would like to share a little testimony with us. So Brother Daly, can you please come up?
Happy Sabbath, Church. Happy Sabbath. It was good for us to be here today. You know, I just want to share, last month this time, I was in Jamaica getting ready to put my brother to rest. But I just want to, on behalf of my family, I just want to give all, each and every one to support us with prayers and others' words. And it make up very much to us, and it strengthen us. It took me personal to know. I can tell you something. I boast for my church family. Because when my brother passed off this Thursday night, and my wife passed it on to Sister Claudette, two, my phone was off the ring. Phone just ringing off. And I said, oh my God, it was good for this family I have. So I give you all the credit, and I give you thanks, and let us keep on be with others when they have their loved one pass off. But not only the time of death, we must be with them. At all times, in the good times, in the bad times. So we thank you. I thank you, all of you, for your support. And one little thing come to my mind all the time. Let us don't forget those parents down in Texas. We lost their children. When I listen to news, my heart bleed. Because it could be anyone. It could be anybody's grandchild, anybody's child. So let us remember them at all times in our prayer. Happy Sabbath.
It's all about we must be our brother's keeper. Amen? Yes, we must always be our brother's keeper. Let us uplift each other. It's a high and sharp, not high and. So as we worship today, may we experience the worship in fullness. And we all said that this day we had experienced the presence of the Holy Ghost. So at this time, we will call and our Sister Selena.
The hymn is hymn 422, Marching to Zion.
Brethren, let's stand to sing this beautiful hymn. Let's go to the second standard. Let those refuse to sing. Ready? Let those refuse to sing who never knew our God, but children of the only King, but children of the only King may speak. Their joy abroad may see, their joy abroad. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. The hills of Zion Hill, a thousand cities sweet. But till we reach the heavenly field, before we reach the heavenly field or walk the golden street, or walk the golden street. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Then let her songs drop and every tears be dry. We're marching to Emmanuel's ground. We're marching to Emmanuel's ground to favor worlds and I to favor world and I. We're marching. We are marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We are marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. We are marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We are marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God.
The scripture reading is taken from Romans chapter 8, verse 28. I will read in your hearing. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. Amen.
We
We have come to this time where we petition the throne of grace, because burdens are lifted at Calvary. And so I ask that you will assume a posture of reverence as we go before the Lord. And we want to ask to just 1 minute, 1 second, so just empty yourselves. Just ask God to just come in and cleanse us so that the Holy Spirit can work through us. Amen. Amen. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Yeah. Heavenly Father, as we come before thy holy presence, O God, we lift you up on high this morning. We praise your holy name. We thank you, Lord, for your loving kindness and your blessings, O God, that you have bestowed upon us, O God. We have gone through a week, dear God, where we didn't know what was going to happen, dear Father. But safely through another week, you have brought us on our way, O God. And so we lift you up on high, dear Father, and magnify your holy name. And to you all praise, all honor and glory, for you alone, O God, is clothed with honor and majesty. So we praise your holy name. This morning, Father God, we want to thank you, Lord, for your blessing upon our lives, dear God. We have so many things to say to you, O Father God. So many things, dear Lord. We have sickness, dear Father. We have people who are going through different ailments, O Father God. Even now, dear Lord, we have people in this congregation who are going through pain, suffering, dear God. Father, I have a list here with me, dear Lord. And the list is so long, dear Father God, of people in need of your healing, dear God. And so, Father God, we have no other God beside you, dear Lord. And so, Father God, we come before you, O Father, begging, dear God, for your mercy. Extend your hands of mercy and healing to us, dear Father God. For you are the God of yesterday, today, and forever, dear Father. You have healed the broken heart. You have banded up their wounds, dear Father God. We have seen the blind. We have read about it, dear Father. And we have seen it around us too, dear God. And we need that same spirit. We need that same miracle up in our lives, dear God. Father God, I pray, Lord, that you will help us, dear God, as we go through our suffering, as we go through our pain, dear Father, that we'll have the tenacity to hold on to your unchanging hand, dear God. Be with us, O Father God, and help us, dear Lord. Father God, bring healing to us, dear God, because you are our maker. You are our creator, dear God. And Father God, only you can bring spiritual, physical healing to us, dear God. And we cry out to you because we have no other God. Do not let the enemy stay aside and say, ha-ha, where is their God? Father God, have mercy. You know, Lord, that you're a God who have not dealt with us according to our iniquities. Yes, we are undone, dear Father, but in your wrath, dear Lord, you still show mercy. So, Father God, I pray, Lord, that you will encircle us, Lord, with your love, dear God, and have mercy, O God, and administer your healing to us, dear Father. Father God, this morning I pray for those who are mourning, dear Lord. Father God, you see the heart, dear God. Only you alone understand. And so, Lord, I ask in the name of Jesus that you will just comfort those that are mourning. You said, blessed are those that mourn, for they shall be comforted, dear God. I pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will encircle them too, dear God, and show them your love, dear God, that you will never leave any of us. You'll never forsake us, dear Father. And so, Father, there is coming a time when we'll have the in, in praise instead of despair, dear God. Garment of praise instead of despair, dear God. And we'll have joy instead of mourning, oh God. So help us to be faithful, dear Father God, that reach that shore, dear Lord, where there's no more sorrow, no more pain, no more crying, no more weeping, dear Father. But we will be with our Lord. So we ask, Lord, that you will just continue to be with us, dear Father, and grant us your peace, dear Lord. Father God, I pray for the youth, dear Lord. We see we're living in troublesome times, where the enemy, oh God, is like a flood. But we know, Lord, that you will lift up a standard against him. Father God, we see all the enemies using our youth. We see the shooting. We see the killing. We see all these things going on. And it's the youth, dear Father. So I pray, Lord, that you will intercept them even now, dear God, and grant them wisdom, dear Father. I ask, Lord, that you will break down the partition that the enemy has placed before them, that they are not able to see your light, dear God, and take them out of darkness, dear Lord, and bring them into your marvelous light. Lord, I pray that you will illuminate their path, dear God, and lead them in the path of righteousness. Help us all, dear Lord, that we will have love in our hearts as mothers and fathers, dear God, that when they come, Lord, we can counsel them, give them good counsels, dear Father. So, Father, I ask, Lord, that you will give them a spirit of obedience, that when you call, dear God, they'll answer, dear Father. So, Father, have your way in their lives, dear Father. You're a mighty God who is able to perfect that which concerneth us. So, Father God, I ask, dear Lord, that you will cover them even now, because the enemy is here to kill, steal, and destroy, dear God. Cover them now, Father, wherever our children are, wherever the youths are, dear Father, wherever they are, dear God. Be with them even now, dear God, and take them from the enemy's hand, dear Lord. So, Father God, Lord, it's so much, dear Father. I pray for those, oh God, who are in pain. Who are in pain because of the way that their children are going, dear Lord. I pray, Lord, that you will give them the strength and the courage, dear Father, to just carry on, dear Lord. Father God, I pray for the people in Ukraine. I pray for the people in Russia. You have a people, dear God. You have a people in those places, dear Lord. I pray, Lord, that you will help them, oh Father God. You have said it, we'll have wars and rumors of war, dear Father God. But I pray, Lord, that you will cover your people, oh God. Cover your people, dear Father. And Lord, bring peace, dear God. Bring peace, dear Lord. So many places even now, dear God, is going through famine. Thousands of lives are being lost, dear God. Thousands of lives. We see it in the news every day, dear Father. And it's like there's no hope unless the world come together to feed, oh God, to feed them. Father God, I pray, Lord, that you will send help for them, dear Lord. Send help, dear God. Father, is so much things, oh God, that if we were to stand here to call for help and everything, dear God, we wouldn't move from here. But Father, we know we have a God who we can trust, a mighty God. Oh Father, and into your hands, Lord, we place everything, dear God. And I ask, Lord, that you will bestow love and peace upon us, dear Father. Help us all that we will be faithful to you, oh God, regardless of our circumstances, dear God. Help us that we can rejoice, as Habakkuk says, though the fig tree might not blossom, nothing is going on, but he said, yet I will rejoice in you, oh God. And even though, Lord, Job said, though you slay me, yet will I trust you. We know in this time we'll have trials and tribulation, but he said, be of good cheer, for I have overcome. When we see these things, dear God, we know we ought to look up for redemption, draw it nigh. We see in the supermarket too, Lord, if you don't reach there early, the shelf's almost empty, Father God. So we have the onset, but we know, Lord, if we trust you, you said, oh God, your bread and water shall be sure. So Father, we just want to praise you and thank you for your promises, dear God. Your promise that are comforting to us, dear Lord. So help us, Lord, to stand on your word, to stand on your promises, oh God. I pray, Lord, for the pastor, the leadership of this church, dear God. I pray, Lord, that you will inspire them, dear Father God. Bless them and keep them and give them the faith, Lord, because it's not easy, dear God. So I ask, Lord, that you will cover them wherever they are and cover us all, dear Father. Be with the manservant who is going to break the bread of life. I ask, Lord, that as he break the bread of life, that angels will surround him and protect him, dear Father, and keep him from the enemy. I pray, Lord, that you will hide him behind the cross and that the word he speak today will come through with clarity and that some lives will be touched and we will be renewed and transformed, that when we leave this place, we can say, it was good to be in the house of the Lord. So, Father, we thank you for your blessing. We thank you for your love and lift you up, O God, on high. For you alone is worthy to be praised. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, boys and girls. What's up? All right, today I'm going to be telling y'all the story of Moses. Any of y'all heard of that? All right, how many of y'all are familiar with the story? All right, that's what I'm going to be talking about today. All right, so and when Moses was born, I'm pretty sure he was... He was put in a basket from his mother because apparently the king was about to kill all them little boys and girls or whatever. Just the boys, my bad. And being that his mother didn't want him to die, she put him in a little basket with a little blanket and closed it up and told his little sister to watch as he floats away. Now, as he's floating away, can anyone tell me where did he go? Anyone know where he went at all? All right. Then there's that. But he went to Egypt where he was found by this Egyptian princess, apparently. And, well, does anyone know what she named the little boy? You're right there with the blue shirt. Now, why did she name him Moses? All right, the reason why she called him, because she found him in the water. after he got put as the prince, after Moses was put as the prince of Egypt, All right, forget that question I was about to say. You know what? Being that he was the prince or whatever, he was gonna eventually become the king or stay the prince of Egypt or whatever. And he got along with his mother's second child. They played around and did a lot together. And can anyone say what they both wanted to become when they got older.
The king of Egypt.
No, yeah. Now, being that one of them were going to become the king of Egypt, one of them had to train a lot, do a lot to become king of Egypt. Now, one day after they were like 14, 13, whatever, Moses was looking at the slaves and whatever. And he seen that the old man was trying to plant a plant or whatever. And seeing that he couldn't do it himself, he asked if he needed help. Now, he helped that man, and once he helped him, he seen another slave getting bullied by the slave owner. Now, the slave owner was beating him for no reason, so he chose to come and help him. And once he helped him, he accidentally killed the slave master. After doing so, he had to run. He had to run from Pharaoh because, I ain't got nothing else to say, but who wants to pray for the ending of this? You right there, little boy. Two can actually pray for this.
Dear God, dear Sister Glory, Dick has great thanks for you. Dick has the good day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. Let's say, amen for the boys and girls. Amen. Amen. So now today, at this time, would be tithe and offering. It's my honor to come to you for the tithe and offering. And as you see on the screen behind me, there's different ways that you can participate. For you who are here today, the deacons will come forward to receive your tithe and offering. And online, you'll see up here how you can give. Deacons. Honor the Lord with thy substance and with the first fruits of all thine increase. So shall thy barns be filled with plenty. And the presses shall burst out with new wine. Acts of generosity and benevolence were designed by God to keep the hearts of the children of men tender and sympathetic. So today, the deacons will take your tithes and offering. bring ye all the tithes in the storehouse, that there may be food in mine house. And try me now, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing, that there may not be room enough to receive it. Shall we pray? Our God and our Father, we just want to thank you again that, O Lord, that your spirit alive to come today to worship and lift up your name. So as we do, O Lord, we thank you for those who return tithes and offering. And Lord, those who do not have, I pray, Lord, you may make a way out for them, O Lord, that they may participate too. Lord, I pray, just thanking you again. Bless us and touch our hearts, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. It's time now for praise and worship. Please let's sit back and experience.
Praise the Lord, church. Praise the Lord, wherever you are, wherever you are doing, I want you to give God the praise that he deserves. Clap your hands, stand up, wave your hands in the air, and give him praise, because he is glorious. Amen? Sing. When you come into his presence, lifting up the name of Jesus, and you hear the music playing, and you see the people praising, just forget about your worries, let your troubles fall behind you. Don't you wait another minute, just get up and on your feet and get dancing, singing, jumping, leaving, get shouting, make it loud and glorious. Start rejoicing. Get shouting, make it loud and glorious. Oh, 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 yeah. Hey, hey, hey. When you come into his presence, lifting up the name of Jesus, and you hear the music playing, and you see, just forget about
let your troubles fall behind you.
Don't you wait.
Just get up and on your feet.
Get to dancing, praising, singing.
Get shouting.
Make a lot of stop rejoicing.
Praising.
Lifting, raising. Get shouting. Make a lot of get to dancing, to dancing. Singing, jumping.
I was created.
victory belongs to Jesus. In him, there's victory. In him, there's power. In him, no matter what, you can depend on him. Amen. So wherever you are, sing along with me. The song says, who will stand against the Lord? No one can, no one will. Who will stand against the King? No one can, no one will. Oh, victory belongs to Jesus. Yes, victory belongs to him. Victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to him. Who can say it? Who will stand against the Lord? Nobody can.
No one can.
No one.
No one will.
Oh, who will stand?
Who will stand against the King?
Nobody can.
No one can.
No one.
No one will.
So sing along and say, victory belongs to Jesus, I know.
Victory belongs to him.
No matter what, yes, I know. Yes, I know. That victory belongs
to Jesus.
Yes, I know. Oh, sing along. Oh, oh, oh. Victory belongs to Jesus. Yes, I know. Oh, victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to him. So we put our trust in you. Yes, we put our hope in you. You will deliver. You're a provider. I find my victory. Forever victorious. Forever we win. Oh, victory belongs. victory. Oh, I know victory belongs to Him. Hallelujah.
Amen. Can you hear me? Amen. Amen. God is good. Amen. And the devil is a liar. Always. The privilege is mine to introduce the speaker of the hour. Elder Cyrus Taylor. Tyler or Taylor? Cyrus Taylor. Now, Elder Cyrus Taylor was born and raised in Georgetown, Guyana. So some years ago, he migrated to the United States where he can have more opportunity to develop his skill for service to God and to the world. Today, Elder Taylor is pursuing a bachelor's degree in church leadership from Oakwood University. He also served on the pastoral staff at Bronx SDA Church in Bronx with Dr. Kendall Guy as a senior pastor. He was recently elected VP, Vice President of the Bronx Manhattan Youth Federation in New York. Elder Taylor, his favorite text is Jude 2:4. That is Elder Taylor's favorite text. But before we hear from Elder Taylor, he's charged up and ready to fire with the word of God. But before we hear him, we'll have a special. And then the man of God will step forward.
Empty and broken, I came back to Him, a vessel unworthy, so scarred with sin. But He did not dismay, He started over again, and I bless the day He didn't throw my clay away. And over and over, He molds me and makes me into His likeness. He fashions the clay, a vessel of honor. Didn't throw the clay away. He is the potter, and I am the clay, molded in His image. He wants me to stay. But when I stumble and I fall, and my vessel it breaks, He just picks up the pieces. He doesn't throw my clay away. And over and
Okay, I want to ask a question. How many of you bring your email to church today? Let me see. Okay, I know, the phone. Let's look for hymn number 251. I want you to remember this as you consider the words. 251, I know you use your phones, so let's use those phones. Hymn number 251. He lives. Ready? I know you ready. All right. I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I see His hands of mercy, I hear His nails of awe. And else one time I see Him, He's always there. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and He talks with me a long life narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me, oh, I know He lives within my heart. In all the worlds around me, I see His loving fear. And though my heart's grow weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading, and all His army blessed. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and He talks with me a long life narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. He walks me out, I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujah to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the hope of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and He talks with me a long life narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. He walks me out, I know He lives. He lives within my heart. Is that true? Is that true? Amen.
Happy Sabbath. Okay, this is it. How are you guys doing today? Indeed, God lives. Not yesterday, today. And if you're thinking about, you're not sure how you're going to get through tomorrow, he's going to be living tomorrow. Come on now. Because he's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. If there's one person you can put your trust in, is God. If there's one person you can lean on fully, is God. If there's one person who loves you knowing all your stuff, is God. So when we come here in the house, I don't know about you, but usually when I come into church, I don't come now with a Sabbath praise. I come in with a compound praise. Okay, you guys are not familiar with what that is. A compound praise is a praise that's not just for today, but it's a praise that's for every other day that allowed me to be here today. Come on now. So when we come into God's house, we ought not come in here with an anemic praise. We ought to come into this house with some compound praise. And compound praise says that I can't just give God thanks for Sabbath. I got to give him thanks for Friday. Come on now. Because if he didn't keep me through Friday, I couldn't come in on Sabbath. And I got to give him thanks for not just Friday, but I got to give him thanks for Thursday. Come on now. Because if he didn't keep me through Thursday, I couldn't get to Friday, which allowed me to be here today. And so when we come in the house, we ought to give God something that is worthy of praise. I like coming into this house. I'm no stranger here. I want to thank you, Elder, for the song and for all the musicians. I'm just always amazed when I hear singing. And it reminds me that at some point, my time will be up. There's going to come a time where you're going to have the last sermon. But you'll never have the last song. And so all of those who are planning on going to heaven that tell the person that asked you to sing that you can't sing, come on now. If you're planning on going to heaven, you got to learn how to sing. You don't have to learn how to preach, but you got to learn how to sing. Come on now. Because the angels in heaven are singing all day long. And if we're going to join them, we got to learn how to, come on now, we got to tune our voices. So every time we have Sabbath worship, we're tuning our voices. Every time we have morning and evening devotion, what we're doing is we're getting ourselves ready for that day when we no longer will hear sermons, but all we have to do is praise God's name. And so every time I hear singing, I can't help but wonder if we sound this way, coming short. The Bible says, all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. And if singing, and you heard on the screen, and you've seen here in the sanctuary, if we come short, if this is how we sound coming short, what will happen when this corruptible puts on incorruption and this mortal puts on immortality? Come on now. I don't know about you, but I want to be there to hear it. Come on, somebody. Because if it sounds this good in sin, and there's no sin hindering you from getting to the soprano note, come on now. When the alto can sing with no restraints, I don't need water. Come on now. I'll be singing for days. I don't need water. What's going to happen is I need to be there. What about you? I bring you greetings from my pastor, Pastor Kendall Guy, at the Bronx Seventh-day Adventist Church. I also bring you greetings from the Bronx Manhattan Youth Federation here in the house today. I want to thank your pastor for allowing me the opportunity to speak in the pulpit today. He's a great man. I hope you're praying for your pastor. Come on now. I hope when you go to sleep, before you go to sleep at night, that you're praying for your pastor. Because the enemy is after your pastor. And it is our responsibility as members of the flock to pray for our pastors. And so you have a great pastor. He's an amazing man of God, and I bless God for him, and I thank God for him and allowing me to have this opportunity here today. Last but not least, I want to thank God for allowing me to be alive. Come on now. We take being alive on Sabbath as such a privilege. But if we look around in the news, we've seen the shootings, we've seen the killings. Come on now. And we're here today, and because we're here today, we ought to give God some thanks and praise for that, because we didn't have to be here. God still got work for us to do in the house. And so I look in the back, I see the hours far spent. You guys know I'm no stranger here. You know, the last time I was here was about, what, 2 years ago, I believe? No? When was it? A couple of months ago? Oh, praise the Lord. Okay. A couple of months ago. But you guys know the beatitude. I look in the back. You got the clock looks nice. I can't really tell what time it is specifically, but I operate by a particular beatitude. And that beatitude is, blessed is the man that gets straight to the point, for he shall be invited back again. You guys heard that? You never heard that? Blessed is the man that gets straight to the point, for he shall be invited back again. I was reading an article online recently, and this was for church, and the author said there's a thin line between a long church service and a hostage situation. You guys are gonna get that later. We came in here to preach the word. We want God to do his thing. And so, if you don't mind, I want to ask you to open your Bibles with me. We're going to go over into the Old Testament, 1 Kings. That will be where we will be pitching our sermonic tent, 1 Kings chapter 19. I want to ask you to stand with me as we read 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19. I'm going to read from the New Living Translation. I've decided today, I've brought my electronics, but I've decided today to read directly from the Word. And not that the electronics are bad, but what happened is I was doing some work and I forgot to charge up the iPad. And while I was doing my work, I wasn't paying attention, the iPad died. And God reminded me that even though the iPad is great, this book doesn't need a charge. Come on now. This book actually charges me. Come on, somebody. And so the word is, when you get in the pulpit today, preach from the book. Nothing wrong with the iPad, but preach from the book. 1 Kings 19. I'm going to read New Living Translation. You can follow along in your other versions. New Living Translation puts it this way. When Ahab got home, he told Jezebel everything Elijah had done, including the way he had killed all the prophets of Baal. So Jezebel sent this message to Elijah: may the gods strike me and even kill me if by this time tomorrow I have not killed you just as you killed them. Elijah was afraid and fled for his life. He went to Beersheba, a town in Judah, and he left his servant there. Then he went on alone into the wilderness, traveling all day. He sat down under a solitary broom tree and prayed that he might die. "I have had enough, Lord," he said. "Take my life, for I am no better than my ancestors who have already died." Verse 5. Then he lay down and slept under the broom tree. But as he was sleeping, an angel touched him and told him, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and there beside his head was some bread baked on hot stones and a jar of water. So he ate and drank and lay down again. Verse 7, then the angel of the Lord came again and touched him and said, "Get up and eat some more, or the journey ahead of you will be too much for you." Verse 8, so he got up and ate and drank, and the food gave him enough strength to travel 40 days and 40 nights to Mount Sinai, the Mount of God. I want to preach to us this morning from a subject matter that is entitled, "Get Up and Eat." Get up and eat. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this word. In Jesus' name, Amen. You may be seated. Get up and eat. Almost sounds like a West Indian parent telling a child to get up and eat. The reason I say that is because I remember my grandmother would mention these exact words to me. When I was younger, I had this tenacity. When I was younger, if I started a project, I did not want to stop or break to eat food. I wanted to make sure that when I started the project, that I completed the project. Come on now. Is anybody in the house with me? And so if there is something in the project that is not working, I wouldn't take a break. Instead, I would keep at it until I figured it out. There's sometimes when I was younger, when I was in high school and beyond, and before that, I'm trying to study because I had to be the best in school. Come on now. I wasn't sure. There were some times where I did not understand the math equation. I did not understand the subject and the verb agreement. And so what I did was I continued to press on that thing until it was done, until I understood it. And there are times where I would press for so many hours that I got frustrated. And my grandmother would see me studying, see me working on the project, and she said, "Son, get up and eat." And I would say, "Grandma, I'm coming. I'm coming right now. I'm preparing myself to get up, but I won't get up." And the more I try to figure out what's going on the exam, what's going on the project, the more I actually got frustrated. And the reason I got frustrated is because you can't focus on a project to completion if your brain is not nourished. It is food that gives your brain nourishment to focus on the project. And I suspect that the reason why many of us are frustrated is because we're focusing on projects so long that we're forgetting to eat from the Word of God. We're focusing on things around in the environment so hard that when God says it's time for Sabbath rest, we can't do it. And so what the text is really telling us, what the text is really trying to inform us, is that we ought to learn how to take some rest when we work so hard. There's a reason why God says, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. There's a reason why God starts out by saying remember, because he knew that we would get so caught up that we would forget to remember the Sabbath day. And so my grandmother would tell me, get up and eat, and sometimes she'd have to take out what is called the belt, the corrector. Okay, some people are looking and they're saying, you had an abusive grandmother. I grew up in Guyana, praise the Lord, hallelujah. There was a time here my cousin, his mom left him. She said, I'm going to church. And she said, hey, listen, if he acts up, give him the rod of correction. And the boy did something, because I didn't know that you can pick up the phone and call the cops. I didn't know that. And so the boy decided that he was going to slide down the stairs and do whatever he's doing. And we lived at a time on a top floor. And I told him, I said, listen, man, you're making too much noise. You know, there's neighbors downstairs. Just hang out. Just take it easy. And he continued to ignore me because obviously I wasn't going to do anything. I had came here with this thick Guyanese accent. And it was funny to him to hear me speak. So he just loved doing things when I say, stop doing it, so you can hear the accent. Yeah, that was fun for him. And so I decided that after about 45 minutes of speaking, praise the Lord, I was going to pick up the rod of correction. And when I picked up the rod of correction, he ran over to the phone. And he told me that he was going to call the cops on me. And so I said, well, when you call them, make sure that they appear by osmosis.
Because before they get here, you will be corrected in righteousness. Come on now. Long story short, the boy starts puffing and huffing. He puts the phone down. I put the belt down. He takes a shower and he goes to sleep. Come on now. Sometimes we need that correction in our lives. Come on now. And the Bible says that if a man loves his son, he corrects him. Come on now. And so I was told to get up and eat because I could not figure out, I could not get through without nourishment. And here in the text, Elijah has a string of miracles that he can draw from. If we go back to 1 Kings chapter 17, Elijah is fed by ravens. God tells him to go down by a brook and wait there for instructions. He goes down by the brook, and the Bible says there's a famine in the land. There's a drought in the land, rather. There's no water coming down from the rain. And Elijah here is said to stay at this brook. And every day he went at the brook, he drank from the brook. Perhaps when everybody else in Queens did not have water running through their faucets. Come on now. Elijah had a brook. And I want you to understand that whenever there is COVID around, whenever there's a down economy coming out, God always has a brook. At the times where we are so concerned about the job market, we're so concerned about housing market, we're so concerned about all these other things, but I want you to know that God has a brook for his people. Come on now. And if we would learn to listen to God when everybody else around is struggling, we will have a place to drink from called the brook. And so here Elijah is sitting here and he's drinking from the brook. He's nourishing his body in this time of famine, this time of drought. I don't want the people of God to miss this, that because we're having a shortage that we have to be short. Come on now. Bible says the arm of the Lord is not short that it cannot save. Come on now. So when they talk about shortage, you got to ask them who they're talking about it for. Because I don't have shortage, even when there is shortage. Come on, somebody. Because my supply does not come from a stimulus check. Hey, come on now. My sustenance does not come from the U.S. government. Come on now. It comes straight from God. And there are places and spaces that God has reserved sustenance just for you and just for me. So when they talk about shortage, they're not talking about me. They're not talking about you here at Queens Faith Temple. Come on now. Bible says that Elijah has experience. He has experience in miracles. Then the brook dries up one day, and Bible says now, and the brook dries up, he gets instructions to go down to a different town, and he now appears to a widow. The widow does not have any money to make food for Elijah, much as her entire family. And so Elijah goes down and he tells his widow, he says, listen, I've come in the house, make me some bread. Come on now. Put some butter on top of it. Come on now. Yeah. You know what I'm talking about? Remember back home when my parents made that bread from that oven, that brick oven that was outside? No, you guys know about that, right? Yes. When you put the coals under it, yes. Am I the only person here? They put the coals under it, and then you light that thing on the outside. This was outside. I remember it because I took the bread, the raw bread, from upstairs, brought it downstairs, pushed it in the oven. And when they put that coal in that thing, and that thing baked, come on now. When it comes out, right as it comes out, I was there with the butter. Come on now. To put the butter on top. And I had to get the first one. Come on now. Because that was my favorite hobby. I love to eat what my mother made. My mom made some good bread. Come on now. I did not allow that bread to go to waste. As soon as it came out of the oven, I had to have the first one because that thing was so good. Come on now. Somebody said hot and ready. And so now, Elijah tells her, hey, I need you to make me a bread. Make me something to eat because I need to be sustained. It's interesting that this God of all people, God would send Elijah to get sustenance from somebody who does not have sustenance. the text says that this was a widow. And the implication is not so much so that she doesn't have a husband or that her husband has died. The implication here in the text is really suggesting that she does not have the means to provide what this man is asking for legitimately. If you look at it from a logical perspective, what's happening here is that this cannot be. Elijah makes a request. He says, make for me first. And the problem with this is that maybe Elijah doesn't know my situation. Maybe Elijah doesn't understand that I haven't worked for years. Maybe he doesn't understand that I don't have any stocks. This is it. I'm done. I don't have any money, and what you're asking me for, I cannot perform. Do you feel like God sometimes asks you to give tithe and offering when you don't have any money? Do you feel sometimes that God asks you to do tasks that seem ridiculous, knowing your circumstance? But the reason God is asking you to perform a task that seems ridiculous is perhaps because you've plateaued on your miracle experiences. So every single day, come on now, every single day, we got used to a certain level of miracles. And God says, I don't want you to get stuck on just this type of miracle. I want you to elevate. Come on now. The problem in the church is that we're doing too many upgrades on our cell phones and not in our faith. Come on now. Every single ever so often, you got your cell phone saying, this will install later on tonight. This will give you a new software. Come on now. While you are in 2022, still operating on 2019 faith. And sometimes it's not that the job is not out there. It's that you and I have the doubt in our hearts that can't produce the result that we want and are asking God for. And so God now sends this man of God to this woman, and he says, make me one first. And she says, hey, listen, I can't do that because I ain't got no money. And Elijah says, oh, don't worry about it. Thus saith the Lord. Come on now. I don't have, but thus saith the Lord. And if the people of God will learn how to add a thus saith the Lord after every single deficiency they have, they'll see some new miracles in their life. Come on now. And so he says, listen, just thus saith the Lord. What's happening here is that you're not gonna starve. I know that there's a shortage, but you're not going to starve. And so watch this. What she does, she goes and she actually makes the bread and she brings it to Elijah and he asks her for water. Another ridiculous request. At this time, Elijah had already appeared before Ahab and he had said there's not going to be any rain in the land. And so why would you come to me asking for water knowing it's a drought? Where am I going to get it from? But if you read the text, the Bible says that not only did she bring bread, but she also brought water. She brought the water and she gave it to Elijah. And the Bible says that when she got back, come on now, the thing that was supposed to be done began to multiply. Come on now. The thing that was supposed to be depleted now begins to divide and to multiply. And what she thought she could not do, now she can do for herself and her family. Come on now. Because what happens is when we trust God, God multiplies not just for me, but God multiplies for you. And God multiplies for your grandchildren and your great-grandchildren. So when you stand on what God says, you ought to know that it's not just for me. They're going to hear about this years down the line. And they're going to ask, how is it possible? And you're going to tell them, it is because of the grace of God. It is because of God's provision as to why we were able to do this. Here people say, I bought a house in the Hamptons, but my credit wasn't all that. Hey, how did you do it? I didn't have the money. How did you do it? People say, I've had all these kids in school at once. I remember this one guy told me, he said, because we have four jobs. It is more important for me to get my bills paid than to get my spiritual soul fed. But we'll come to church on Sabbath, we'll spend some time in praise and worship, and then we'll go back worried about how we're going to pay these bills that we got. Come on now. They've forgotten completely about what God has said, how God has delivered in the past, and so what they start doing now is they begin to build idols. They're in bad shape. And we look at Israel of old and we say, how can they do that? But the reality is, in right now, this 2022, in these United States of America, we have gods just like they had gods back then. Their gods were erected with stone and wood. Our gods are erected in bank accounts. I'm not suggesting that you should not have your investments or do not plan for your financial future. But what I'm suggesting is when your financial future becomes more important than your salvific future, we're in problems. Because one day I won't need money. One day it's not going to be how wealthy I was. All that will be passed away. Elijah appears on Mount Carmel to take care of a matter that should have never gotten to this place. And the reality is that if we are going to prevent idols, if we're going to prevent getting idolatry in the church, we've got to make sure that God is kept at the forefront of everything. When we look at Exodus chapter 20, verses 3, Bible says the first commandment is what? Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Israel, for some reason, has allowed God to be pushed in the back burners, and now they have elected officials that are no longer interested in spiritual growth. They've elected people in parliament that are no longer interested in the freedoms of the people. Here we have a problem, and God sees the problem, and God says, I need to take heed, because this, if it doesn't get fixed here, it will continue to perpetuate. So he comes now, Elijah comes down, and he comes down on Mount Carmel. He says, listen, you guys been hanging out with the wrong crowd for a long time, and you don't know who God is. And as a believer, as a Christian, we got to understand that we need to know who God is, because if we don't know who God is, anybody can make their identity with us. If I don't know who my God is, if I don't know how to speak to people, come on now, then what happens is I begin to write a story that is not God's story. And so here, Elijah says, you guys, we gotta get back to basics. I need you to understand who God is. And so he says, let me show you who God is. Come down to Mount Carmel. Let's have a showdown. Let's see if your God is really who you say he is. And many a times on the street, we have people who are asking us the same question. Let me see exactly who your God is. And we're afraid to challenge them because we of ourselves don't really have that solid relationship with God to the point that we can put him on display so that the world can see his miracles. So he gets them together there on Mount Carmel. Bible says that Elijah tells them they can pray for the half of the day so that they can see if their God shows up. And after their God shows up, he says, I'm going to pray to my God. And my God's going to show up, and let the God who responds by fire be the true God. And we know this from reading the text, from reading the Old Testament, that God indeed is a God of fire. When he appeared before Moses, come on now, how did he appear? In a burning bush that did not consume, it was fire. Come on now. When he was found with the three Hebrew boys, they were found walking around in the middle of the fire. And the king said, throw them in because they were afraid to, because they did not obey my command. But when they actually were in the fire, Bible says that he looked at the fire and he asked his counselors, he said, did we not cast three men in? Come on now. He said, lo, behold, I see a fourth one, and the fourth one is like the Son of God. They're walking around in the middle of the fire. They did not have any hurt, and they're loose. Come on now. Because whenever God shows up as fire. Jeremiah had it. He says, I have this fire that shut up in my bones. I can't keep it in. And regardless of where you live, people ought to know what you believe in. Come on now. If you live in the hood, people ought to know what you believe in the hood. If you live in a gated community, people ought to know what you believe in. They ought to know because there's something inside of you that's like fire. And so they come and they're on Mount Carmel. The Bible says that Elijah puts the sacrifice on the altar. And he does another ridiculous thing. They pour water around it. And then asks for God to respond by fire. Now, I don't know about you, but you've got to understand that when you pour water on wood, it doesn't light. Any master guys in the house? Any pathfinders in the house? We better start learning camping skills. Praise the Lord. If we don't learn camping skills, we're gonna be in trouble. We better start learning wild edible plants. Praise the Lord. Come on, somebody. We better start learning knots. Come on now. This is important information for us. And so Elijah asked him to pour water all over the sacrifice. The sacrifice is now drenched in water, and he's praying for God to respond by fire. Bible says after prayer happens, Elijah, the fire from heaven came down, licked up all the water, all the sacrifice, and the people saw that God was indeed God, and they worshipped. Then Elijah decides, you know, if we're going to continue in this way, we've got to take out the root of the problem. And it seems cruel, it seems bad that Elijah would have to slew these prophets. But in order for him to make sure that he continues what God has set aside for him to do, he had to do this work. And what happens a lot of times in church and what happens a lot of times in our lives is that we want to avoid the problem instead of taking the problem out. And how we avoid the problem is this. We'll see something coming that could be a problem and we'll say, you know what? I don't want to deal with that right now. I'm not a confrontational person. And so what I'll do is I'll just let it go. And what happens is you let it go and it slips by for 1 year, it slips by for 2 years, and in the third year, the thing that you avoided in 2019 comes back. And when it comes back 5 times, 10 times hotter than it was before. And so here, watch this. Elijah says, I got to take out these prophets of Baal. And when I take them out, watch this. I got to make sure that we are setting the stage for proper righteousness in the land. Jezebel apparently was home, perhaps washing dishes. Maybe she was out in the garden. Maybe she was out mowing the lawns. I don't know, but Jezebel was home. This took place. Elijah saw everything. And now Elijah comes back to report to his wife. He says, listen, Elijah came in town. They had a concert on Mount Carmel, and my prophets are gone. Jezebel gets upset, and she says, guess what, Elijah? I'm going to take you out just as you've taken out my prophets. Bible says that when Elijah heard these words, he was afraid and ran for his life. Now, my question is, how is this possible? How can you see so many miracles in your life and still run away when Jezebel speaks to you? Come on now. It's not Jesus giving you judgment, it's Jezebel. How is it possible that you could have been in church for so long and still cannot go show up at somebody's house when they ask for special prayer or if somebody asks you to go over to pray because there's some paranormal activity, I don't want to show up? There's a guy a few years ago, I was preaching at a church. He says, I need you to come to my house and pray because my mother seems to be troubled by something. And I've tried to get the pastors, I've tried to get the people, the elders involved, but they don't want to come in. And I said, well, what have you said to them? He said, I've said to them that there's something troubling her. She hits her head, there's bruises on her. I can hear stuff happening at the house. I just need prayer. And no one wants to touch the issue. I said, how many are these young elders? No, they're aged, they're seasoned elders. So why is it that we've been in church, we know the power of God, but we still don't want to touch the issue? Elijah hears a message, and what he hears is, I'm going to die. And he runs. And what this text really shows us is Elijah perhaps is tired. It's not necessarily that he doesn't have faith, but he's tired. It's not that I don't believe in the Sabbath, I'm tired. I'm tired of seeing people gunned down in the streets. I'm tired of seeing the government take out taxes out of my paycheck that they didn't work for. I'm tired of having to go through the numbers of how many people died by COVID. I'm tired of seeing it year after year. I've got to live in fear that when I go out, I may be shot down in the street. I'm tired of having to be afraid when I see blue lights and red lights behind me because I've known the statistics of what happens when black men get pulled over by the cops. I'm tired. And so Elijah perhaps has hit a place of being tired. And now when he hears from Jezebel, he runs. He says, I can't do this anymore. And he takes his flight and he leaves his servant. What happens is this, when you get tired, the people that are supposed to be your support system, you run and you leave them. The people that are supposed to help pray for you, the people that are supposed to support you in your journey, you run away. You get separated from them. And you run away into seclusion. This is exactly where the enemy wants you. The enemy wants you in a place where you have no help. No one can give you advice. No one can pray for you on your behalf. You're entering into a zone that's so deep and so dark that it appears as though you cannot come back. But for the person who may be saying, I'm no longer interested in doing ministry, I want you to know that wherever you find God, wherever you run from God, you run to God. Because God is omnipresent. David says, if I decided I wanted to go into hell, thou art there. Come on now. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad that God is every single where I can think of going. Come on now. Because if there's a place that I can go and God is not there, then I don't deserve to serve a God like that. I deserve to serve a God who's omnipresent. So wherever I decided to run to, he is there to give me hope. He is there to give me encouragement. He is there to lift up my weary soul. And there's a lot of people in church today who's afraid, who is weary because they've been in church for so long. And they still haven't seen certain things change. You ought to turn it over to Jesus today. Elijah runs. And watch this. He runs away. And he prays perhaps one of the most depressing prayers in the Bible. And I studied the prayer. And I say sometimes when we pray, we got to be careful what we pray for. But I'm still happy that when we pray, God doesn't answer all of our prayers the way we pray it. Does that make sense? Like Elijah gets on this tree, he's depressed. In his moment of frustration, he prays, God, take me out. God, end my ministry now. God, end my marriage now. God, end my relationship with my kids. They're getting on my nerves now. I don't want to do this anymore. God, I am not built for this. They pray that prayer. And what happens is God listens to the prayer, but answers it in a different way. Come on now. He prays his prayer. Watch this. And he's under a broom tree. And then what? He falls asleep. For those of you who are having trouble sleeping, just pray. Pray your heart out. Come on now. Pray your soul out. And when you do, you'll be so tired, you'll fall out. Come on now. Elijah here does not want to return to ministry. He says, I'm done. Take me out, God. The entire time he's talking, God is listening. And as though God is not heard what he prayed, Bible says that as he falls out under the tree, the angel of the Lord appears unto him and says, get up and eat. Okay, God, I don't think you've heard what I asked for. I asked to leave the church. I asked to be completely taken out of living here. And God says to him, while he's asleep, get up and eat. Maybe the reason that God is responding this way is because when he's ready to finish, when God is ready to finish, that's when it's actually finished. Come on now. Our ministry, our life, our progress, our production is not finished when we're tired. It's finished when God says it's finished. Come on now. And there's sometimes we're ready to be done, but the work is not yet done. And God says there's no one else that can do the work that I've called you to do. I'm not going to put you down so I can raise somebody else up to finish your job. Your job is to finish the work that I have called you to do. And when I've called you, I've equipped you to do exactly that. So I will not answer your prayers for taking you out of the race. Bible says he hears, he gets up, he eats, and he drinks, and he goes back to sleep. Because that's what we want to do in church. Thank you for this short, this light meal, light refreshments. Come on now, haystacks, yes? No, you guys don't know about haystacks. But has anybody had haystacks lately? No? Okay. This light refreshment, God says, get up and eat. And God provides bread and water for him. In his moment of frustration, God supplies bread and water. In his moment of depression, God supplies bread and water. In his moment, when he's feeling like he's coming down with COVID, God provides him with bread and water. This is the kind of bread and water that you can't find in the stores. Come on now. You can't find it in the pharmacy. Come on, somebody. They don't make it at Walmart. This is what God says. When you and I find ourselves running because we're afraid that we're not going to be successful in life, we're afraid that we will not get married, we're afraid that we won't have children, we're afraid that we can't handle the business that God has given us, God says, I need you to know that I will provide bread and water. Your bread and your water is sure. Even in the middle of a pandemic, I will make sure you eat and I'll make sure you drink. He looks over, and the Bible says that right within his arm's reach, he actually gets bread and water. He gets up, He eats it, he drinks it, and he goes back down to sleep. But again, his work is not yet done. Bible says the angel of the Lord comes to him a second time and says, get up and eat again. Because what you ate on Sabbath is not enough to carry you through the week. Come on now. If you've eaten on Sabbath, you've got to eat on Sunday. Come on now. You've got to eat on Monday. Come on now. You've got to eat on Tuesday, because what you ate on Sabbath is not sufficient to carry you on through the week. Come on now. This is why it's important for us to get up in the morning, early, I say, in the morning, and do morning devotion. Come on now. It's important for us to set our alarms early in the morning and in the evening, discipline ourselves that before we go to sleep, we'll spend some time in the Bible, because what happens is a lot of times the reason we run off and we get scared is because we don't have enough bread and water in our system. Bible says that he's told, get up and eat again. He gets up and he eats again. And God says the reason is because the journey is too great for you. So he gets up and he eats again, and when he does, he continues his mileage. Now, the Bible says he traveled for 40 days. Scholars say this is some 300 plus miles that Elijah walks on foot. Come on now. No Ubers, no Lyfts, no dollar vans. Come on now. What does they have? No MTA bus, no train. 300 miles after he just said, I want to die. After Jezebel says, I'm going to take you out. Come on now. I need you to understand there's a progress here. God tells him to get up and eat because the journey is too great for you. Today, God is telling somebody to get up and eat because you've been tired. You're getting tired of waiting on Jesus to come. God says, get up and eat. I know you've been hearing the sermons preached for years and years. He's coming, he's coming, he's coming again. If you look around at the signs, they're getting heavier and heavier. There are more shootings than we've heard before. Come on now. There's a lot more laws and politics that are being passed. If you're paying attention, you'll notice that there's a lot of things happening now that weren't happening so much so about 10 years ago. He's coming soon. Get up and eat. And what I like about the text is that it's interesting to note that the word says get up and eat. It doesn't say eat and then get up. It says get up and eat. Now you looking at me like, man, we don't know what's going on here. Let me help you understand. Elijah is tired. And he's hungry, and he's depleted in strength. And the command from God, just as it did before, came to him in an impossible situation and said, get up and eat. This would be the equivalent of a patient who is laying in a hospital bed, depleted of nutrients, has tired, and the doctor comes in and says, get up and eat. The doctor would not come in and say, get up and eat. The doctor would assign a nurse, if you may, to feed the patient so that they'll have some kind of energy so that after they've had that energy, they can now get up and feed themselves. But Elijah here prays a prayer and he falls out and God says to him, Elijah, get up and eat. How can I get up and eat when I'm depleted? How can I get up and eat when I'm no longer interested in doing ministry? How can I get up and eat when everything I've worked for is gone? God says, this is how I'm going to put it for you. Are you here? Are you in the house with me? I'm almost done. Bible says that God tells him to get up and eat. And the reason God tells him to get up and eat, the reason God says get up and eat first in that order, is because God wants Elijah to know that the reason he gets up is not because of the food he eats, but it's because of the word that he's obeyed. Come on now. The reason you and I are going to rise over the occasion is not because of our degree. It's not because of our investments. It's not because of our connection. It is because we have obeyed the word of God. And whenever you obey the word of God, even if you're tired, God says, I will make sure you get up. Come on now. You could be depressed, but get up. You could be sick, but get up. Come on now. You could be broke, but get up. Because when God says get up, you get up. The word is what gives us the power. Get up and eat. Even in the word, God says, hey, watch this, I'm done. Get up and eat. He provides bread and water. He provides himself the nourishment for your get up and your eat. Okay, okay. The text says, I am the bread of life. Come on now. I am the bread of life. The text says, I am the living water. Come on now. So when I find myself in a circumstance where Jezebel tries to scare me, come on now, what I really need is to ingest some more word. Come on now. If I'm so scared of what's going to happen, it means I've got to turn some more hours in the Bible. I've got to spend some more time in prayer, because the more you pray, the more you get up. The more you eat, the more you get up. The more you pray, the more you overcome. Come on now. The more you feast on the word of God, it's the more the enemy has to back off for you. Come on now. The more you do, God does more. Come on, somebody. Bible says that God can do exceedingly, abundantly, above everything you ask or think or desire. And so I say to you, my friend, get up. Get up and eat even if you don't feel hungry. Get up and eat when you're depressed. Get up and eat when you're sick. Get up and eat when you're feeling lonely. Get up and eat when somebody says there's no room at the table for you. God says, I'm preparing a table in the presence of your enemies. Get up and eat. Get up and eat. And by the grace of God, get up and eat. Amen.
The closing hymn we will be singing, we are nearing home.
Let us stand, brethren, please.
Let us stand.
Get up, brethren, get up. Just over the mountain in the promised land. You know it, so let's sing it. Just over the mountain in the promised land, the holy city lived by God's own hand. That the great king was set in the mountain's breast. We can build our own land of eternal rest. We are near. Yeah.
Shall we pray? Oh, Father in heaven, we just want to give you thanks for your word, for your message today to remind us that we should get up and eat because the journey is too great just for one meal. And just tell us, Father, that we should continue to heed, feed on your word, so that we will sustain your journey, that journey into eternity. Yes, Father, which is truly we are nearing home. We are nearing home. Help us, Father, that we'll continue to heed, so that we will be ready when you come to take us home. Oh, Father, thank you for the privilege of worship. And as you dismiss us from this place, Father, do not dismiss us from your presence. Take us home, your various homes safely. Give us a blessed rest of your Sabbath day. May we continue to ponder these words, to get up and eat. Bless us into the hand. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Shall we see that? Yeah. Us from our worship, we go away. What is the all to the land, safely on in the God will I pray. Amen, amen, amen. Thank Thank you. Thank you, everyone. It was really, we want to thank Elder Cyrus. We want to thank him. May God continue to bless you and he go with you and continue to flourish you as you go on working for him.
Church say,